Okay, so let's try to better understand what these four steps mean in practical terms. Sensing. Sensing means measuring something from the environment or measuring something from the user. I can measure, there are different types, many types of sensors, maybe sensors of that measure the temperature, humidity, lighting, movement, opening or closing of some device, the weight, some any kind of, I would say, any kind of physical quantity you may think of, you will find a sensor able to measure that. Quantities or quality from the environment, but also from the users. Okay, so I can measure noise, I can measure the movement of the user, I can measure the steps, the heart activity, the sweating of the user, the heart pulse or whatever. So, something that is able to capture some physical quantity about the environment or about the user. There are many types of sensors. They may be individual, isolated sensors, or in many cases you have a network of sensors, sensors connected to each other through usually wireless networks, in some cases wired, but in many cases they're wireless. They can be separate sensors. That camera is a sensor, for example, there in the corner, that senses images. Somewhere in the hallway there will be a presence sensor checking whether somebody is walking there or not. And so there are individual sensors. Or maybe you have more complex devices, take a smartphone for example, that embeds 10 different sensors. It has a GPS, an accelerometer, a temperature sensor for the CPU, for example, a camera and a light sensor and so on. So many different sensors that are embedded into maybe a single device. You really, everything you can think of, you can find some device to measure it that may be more or less miniaturized, maybe more or less expensive, maybe more or less precise. But actually, today we are not limited by the availability of sensing equipment. I just select the shopping websites and put something, some query about ambient sensors, and they come up a list of those. But actually, you have, presence, movement, air sensors about, fire sensors, pollution, CO2, temperature of the air. Actually, you name it, you have it. And also, there's a whole world of the wearable sensors. Wearable sensors that come out maybe for just for fun, for sport reasons, like this Fitbit, or maybe for medical reasons. So something that needs to monitor more accurately some physical condition of yours because you need them, because you have a medical condition and you need them. There's an example, I don't know if you know it, about some sensor of brain waves. That is able to detect some brainwave patterns. This is used for video gaming mainly. And so there are many devices that are able to sense on the environment and on the person. So sensing is easy. You can find sensors for everything. The problem is that they generate data. We need sensors to generate sensing data. The problem of data that comes out from sensor is that they are huge. Take a temperature sensor that takes the temperature in an environment every 10 minutes. You have 50 of those. At the end of a 1 month, how many data you have? How many data points you have? Hundreds of thousands. What do you do with all of this data? There are many. They put a load on the database storing them. They are noisy. I want small sensors, cheap sensors, low power sensors, they will be less precise than industry-grade sensors. Maybe I want to put one sensor in every room, I need 50 of them. So it might be a €3 budget for every sensor. It's not the same as building one maybe industrial sensor of, that costs 50 times more, would be more precise. Cheaper ones are more easy to distribute, to be ubiquitous, to be everywhere, but they generate more noisy information. Sometimes they lose connectivity, so you lose some data. Sometimes you just get some value out of range or something strange. It's their nature. Maybe because there's a tram passing by and the sparks create noise, electromagnetic noise that influences the reading. Maybe there's lighting, maybe many different factors that influence that. So I have data, but I have trouble in manipulating those data. They are huge, they are noisy, they are missing points. There may be measures for different physical quantities that need to be compared, or for sensors that are different scales or different precisions. So combining them in a formula, it's easy to write the physical formula on the blackboard. But then when you have real data, it needs to be combined, reconditioned, and rescaled. So there's a lot, it's not the focus of this course. There's a lot of work being done just in making sense of the sensor data. So getting the raw data and polishing them, filtering them, in order to have reliable information so that the intelligent part of the system can take decisions on reliable data, not on raw data, which is always, fluctuating and changing. I remember last year work on the Marco Poli project that I already mentioned before. They tried to build a localization system inside the Politecnico. On paper, it's perfect. We have hundreds of Wi-Fi access points, hotspots, in the different places. If you are standing in any place in the Politecnico, you can check how many access points your phone is able to reach and with what is the power, the transmission power to each of them, the attenuation, let's say. And so you can estimate the distance and you can, from the signature, which are the access points that I am seeing right now, you can more or less understand where you are. Okay, on paper it's fantastic. Try to do that, you will find that access point appear and then disappear and then they change. And then every day is different because depending on the crowd, they shield the electromagnetic signal or the air humidity that changes. Every day will be different. So having a precise reading is very difficult. So the difference from having a measurement and being able to infer reliable information from that measurement. This is one of the problems. Suggestion, in our projects, let's try to avoid this problem, more or less. Okay? Yeah? So try to build systems that don't rely on a lot of noisy data, if possible. Otherwise, we have to suffer. Okay, reasoning is the easiest part, let's say theoretical, because it means programming, means software. Some software that may use the information that has already been sensed, by read and analyzed, and then do something. So this can be server software, algorithms, more or less complex. And we will, in this course, we will choose some environments. We will use Python, we will use Linux as a server, we will use Raspberry Pis as the hardware if we need to do something embedded and not running on the PC, and so on. And we will glue all of this together, we'll make all these devices communicate through HTTP communications, which is the standard today in the Internet of Things. We want the software not just to take decisions, to follow rules, but also to be a bit intelligent or a bit flexible. Again, artificial intelligence is not part of this course. So we don't have time to learn actual proper methods of artificial intelligence. We will only be able to fake it in some way, to pretend it's intelligent when actually it's only flexible and context sensitive. So the system will need to understand. Let me say it this way. What makes a system intelligent? The capability of taking different actions in similar conditions, depending maybe on the context. So if you come home, it does something. But if you come home, you know, with a friend, it does something different. Because the system is able to react to an action that is the same action, I enter my home, in a different context. The context may be the time of the day, maybe another person with me, maybe whatever you want. Okay? So this makes people feel that the system is intelligent, because it's not just reacting like I'm going through a hallway and the light is lit, and then when I go away, the light is switched off. That would be, I wouldn't call it intelligent. I would call it automatic. Automation is an ingredient of intelligence, but it's not enough. So we need a system that is able to take decisions depending on several factors involving user actions. And so we need in some way to have this kind of detection of some of the context. Again, we can think about big systems, but we need to aim something smaller. A bit of intelligence, a bit of context, a bit of choice that the system will have to do is enough for our purpose here. So, starting from the data, we have an algorithm that decides, takes into account a different condition, and then takes a decision. And the decision is translated into an action on the environment. And again, it's the same as with sensors. We have actually all the opportunities of acting, sometimes in a more structured way. So maybe we have a home or building automation system in place for which we can remotely control some devices, some doors, some lights, or some other things in the house. Sometimes this is wireless, so we rely on smart plugs like this one that are reported here, so we can switch on and off the plug, and of course, the load that is associated to them. Or other types of actions. Actions can be light, can be sound, can be vibrations, so maybe with a wearable or with a smartphone. So something that changes or influences the environment. Heating, cooling a place, are all actions that we can imagine. Of course, they need to go through the senses of the person. So there should be actions that can be detected by the person so that they feel the interaction. So that's why usually lights and moving objects and switching on and off things are most, or making noises, sounds, notifications, vibrations are more frequently used. Because they can use them also for interaction with the users, because they feel them. Other types, I change the humidity in the room, yeah, it's an action, but it's not very, it cannot be exploited for interaction. Not directly, indirectly, of course, it can. And then there, in addition to interacting with the user by changing the environment, we may also want to have some more direct interaction. So an actual interface. An interface on a website, or a smartphone, or on a smartwatch, or in your, I don't know, desk lamp that is able to interact with you in some way. Explicit interactions. So you may have implicit interaction through the environment. I do things in the environment, and the environment does something in return, or more explicit interaction. Now I click here and expect this to happen. Okay? like the in the MyPlace project that I showed you, there was some implicit interaction. I walked by there and they put it into the stall, and the stall will feel, will sense the presence of a bike. I don't need to do anything special, I just push the bike there. Then I lock the bike by using the app on the smartphone. And then it will be an explicit interaction. So that we need combinations of two, or both of them. And of course, interacting with the user means using traditional user interfaces, but also using some environment capabilities. So for example, there's a light switch that looks like a light switch, but it isn't. It's just a button that feeds information to my system. It's not a regular light switch, but I hide the computer behind a regular fixture in the environment. One of the trends of ambient intelligence is called the disappearing computers. Having more and more computers, less and less visible, and less perceived by users. Let me make an example. Some of you are from the mechanical or automotive sectors. Automobiles are great in this. I can drive my car today, well, forget about my car. I could drive a luxury car today, and when I drive, when I switch on one car, one, I say medium or top segment car, not my one, today, I am actually switching on 40 to 50 computers. All the electronic control units for the brakes, for the ventilation, for the motor, for the exhaust, for the suspensions, a lot of computers are turning on. But I can drive that car with the very same driver license that I got some years ago, when the cars were only purely mechanical devices. The user interface didn't change. Steering wheel, pedals, and clutch. But everything behind is now computer-driven. When I push on the pedal, I learned that it would change the amount of fuel that goes into the injectors. It's not true anymore. It only changes an input into a computer that decides actually whether and how much fuel to put into your engine. It's all computer-mediated, but I don't feel it. The interaction is with the car. I'm driving the car. I'm not programming the computer to steer right or to increase the speed. Right? We want to reach the same level of immediacy in intelligent ambience. You don't need to activate the function when you're braking on an ice. The system just say, does it work when needed? The computer is there, is working, but it's invisible. People just interact with the device, live, drive. And the system takes care of making it better, making it safer, faster, consuming less fuel, without me knowing that. If I'm pressing too much the pedal, well, just ignores, because it knows that it's just wasted, that it would be wasted, gasoline. Okay, so we try to think about this today. We don't want to add objects in our houses to do new things. We want to have our houses today like they are today, but more clever, with the same devices. Don't think about you or me. We are engineers, we are not humans, okay? We like strange devices. Having something that has a lot of lights and make a lot of noises, yeah, I'm very geek. No. Normal people, humans I mean, normal people just want the functionality, care about the functionality. And the less devices there are, the less they can break up, the less they have a problem to place and to displace. And okay? So, we need to think about what is the best user interface for a system. I've seen a lot of projects that say, okay, you can replace your doorknob, your lock for your home door with a smartphone. But really. So there's something that is so easy, like a key, that you can turn there. No, you need to take your phone, unlock it, write the PIN, open the application right there, and at the same time, it takes 20 seconds, 30 seconds to do something that it only takes a couple of seconds in a normal case. Do we want that? No. Okay? And so think about natural user interfaces. Actions that humans do. Think about video games. Think about the Wii. Think about the Kinect, where the video game is reacting to your natural action. You don't need even to have a controller in your hands. They check your movements, and they react in some way. This is an interface, actually. You are doing those gestures on purpose. But you don't need a new computer for doing that. You are doing that in front of the television, or in front of the wall, or in front of something. This should be the starting point. How the user is able to interact with the system. What is the perception that the user has about the system? What does the user do when in contact with the system? So we should start from this place, from this. Not always. It doesn't always happen. Unfortunately, it doesn't always happen. In many cases, we design a system that is very good from the technology point of view, but it lacks a lot from the usability point of view. I remember just to show you, this is a picture, this is a real picture of a house where I've been there, really. And it's a fully automated house, a lot of smart home devices. And you can imagine that on every door, nearly every door, you can see 3, 6, 9 different buttons. The designer just put them in a vertical instead of a normal horizontal orientation. Nobody knows why. Okay. It changed, the designer changed the color of the plates with no real reason. But you tend to associate that color is different. It should mean something. No, it doesn't. Okay. And what happened is that the people were, say, frightened because there were a lot of black buttons in a row, and you didn't have a clue for what they were doing. And so the next step was they put some icons on the right here. So, but just think about the complexity. You go there, you want to open that door because it's automated. You go there, you squeeze your eyes to see the icons and try to understand which one has the arrow going left or right, and send. And you translate, okay, this is the right icon you want, so you need to press this button on the right side, because there are two lever buttons. They can be pressed on either side to go to an action. But it's easier to grab the handle, please. In that case, the handle was removed because the home was automated. So what happened is that in that house, people felt captive, felt locked down, felt in prison. Because they couldn't control the environment. The environment was capable of doing great things, but people didn't want to touch the buttons because they were afraid that something strange would happen and they wouldn't be able to recover it. So what happened is that in some cases they just put some tape over the button where don't touch this. Okay, because so let's try not to build a monster like this. I'm not going to tell you how much money it costs, such a house. So always think about interaction from the beginning and not only at the end. I like to cite these two tweets that are actually right now they are nearly 2 years old, but they say that actually all the technology that we need is already there. What we need is to package that in a way that users will like it. So let's try to sell services, sell features, sell application, not sell technology to people. This is the, let's say, the step forward that we need to do as engineers to be able to start, let's say, seeing mainstream products and this Internet of Things and not just toys, okay, or very specialized applications. Okay. Okay, so starting from the definition, we decided every MEA system must have four different steps. Sensing, and they will repeat this 94 times over the semester. Sensing, reasoning, acting, and interacting. While developing these four steps, we want them to work in a specific way, with specific qualities. Basically, we want an intelligent system. What does it mean? What are the characteristics that a system must have? So if you go to the literature, you read the papers of people trying to reason about the intelligence, you come up with these six features that they put in this nice flower, because it's nearly spring, so we need to grow flowers. So an MEA system should have these six, or most of these six features. The first two, we already know them, sensitive and responsive. So able to sense and able to respond, to act. We already know them. These are two of our main steps. Okay? Adaptive. Adaptive is a quality of the reasoning. During the reasoning, we need to be adaptive. We need to be able to adapt the action to the context. And for adapting an action to a context, we must first be able to understand the context. What is a context? A context is a combination of information about the environment, about the user, about the habits of the users, about the day of the week. Maybe Monday is different from Sunday in your daily life, usually, I hope so. And so historical data, current data, environmental data, user data, you must combine them in order to understand whether we are in situation A or B or C. So making a high-level context understanding, define a context is, okay, I'm working. How can I know whether a person is working? Well, I can combine the calendar, I can combine the location, I can combine the action, the movement, and so on. And so I can understand that if I am at 7 o'clock in the evening in a classroom at Politecnico, I'm not having a fun, but I'm working. I'm also trying to have fun, by the way, in the same time. But basically, I need to put together the time and the location, for example, and maybe also the class schedule. And so I can understand a condition. So our system must be able to understand some context and detect this context by analyzing data, sensor data. This enables the system to be adaptive. So being able, in a given condition, when the phone rings, if I'm working, it doesn't ring, for example. So I don't need to silence it before every class, and then I forget it silences for 4 days, and my wife gets angry. So this is one way, one quality, one feature that we need to take in mind when you are building the software, not just applying a rule like just always the same rule in a blind way. A system should be transparent, like I said before, they disappear in computers. Now, the most profound technologies are those that disappear, that you don't see them. And they weave themselves into the fabric of everyday life until they are indistinguishable from it. So hiding computers, hiding interfaces, transforming objects, everyday objects, into interfaces for the system. This is the trend we are going. If you look at some science fiction, it's full of those examples. Okay? And it's more complex than it seems. I don't know, I saw this picture from science fiction. If you have moving doors, okay? Even here at the ground floor, there are a lot of doors that just, as you approach, they open. But they're still, all of them are still stupid, because if you are chatting with a friend besides the door, it will keep opening again. So it, that is, we are not here that yet. There's no intelligence in the system. It's a stupid door. Another quality, so adaptive, transparent. Transparent is a property of the interfaces. Interfaces should hide as much as possible the computer and try to make interaction natural with what is expected to be there by the user. Ubiquitous means being everywhere. So a system that is not a centralized system, which you have a computer and everything happens there. You have sensors in different places. You have different nodes of computation in different places. Every node computes some quantities, and then they interact with each other. And in some cases, ubiquitous can be also pushed even farther. So with a strong miniaturization, very small devices that come out in, not in tens or hundreds, but be in thousands. And they are disseminated onto all the people, all the objects, all the cars, or something like that. So something very cheap, very small, that is able to be distributed as much as possible. Of course, it depends on the application that you want. And but again, this in our project, it would be difficult to achieve because it will require a larger scale. But of course, we can imagine a larger scale and then build it for just for one room, so with less sensor or less devices. OK, intelligence is what we already aimed for. As I said, we don't have time, resources, or whatever to do, to learn how to do proper artificial intelligence. Of course, it's a course in the master degree. It is called artificial intelligence, where you can learn how with other techniques. So we can only maybe use some libraries or some very specialized approach. If there are some project that will need a bit of real artificial intelligence, we can maybe help you, give you some reference on how to do that. But we won't be able to do it properly here. But in general, an MEI system should have embedded intelligence system, so the intelligence should be there. Okay, these are the qualities that we are wanting. So when we are thinking about a project, I want to do a project for X. We can ask ourselves, is it an ambient intelligence project? It is, if it contains the four steps and is able to cover as much as possible these six features. Maybe not all of this, or not all in the same way. Maybe it's more about sensing or more about intelligence. Not all the applications are able to lend themselves to be equally deep in every of these, in every of these features. But all this should be there in some way. Okay, this is our mind filter. Everything we think, we try to filter it with this quantity, the four steps and the six features. If you come up with a project that is in the domain, in the theme of the year that we are now going to present, and fits these four plus six safe conditions, then it's a good project. And it is accepted. So we are not in the course evaluating whether a project is nicer than another, or this is more useful or not, or this makes a market, may have a stronger impact on the market or more profits. We don't care. We care about a system that you like, that you will have fun building, and will respect this criteria. So this is what you are looking for. And this year, every year, you know that we have a different theme, and It's not a surprise because I already wrote that in the survey. The theme for this year is ambient intelligence for health and well-being. It's a very broad topic so that you can find what you prefer. So we try to reason about this definition to give you some idea, some pointers, how to start thinking. So, MES system, let's break down the definition of the team. So a system, a computer system that implements the four steps and tries to cover as much as possible the six features or most of them. This is what we require as an MEI system. If it's missing one of the steps, it's not acceptable as a project. So we will ask when you propose the project to detail, well, why is it sensible? Why is it, what is the sensing, what is the acting, what is the reasoning? Just to check that you have reason about that. Four, health and well-being. Means something that impacts on the health of the persons, on the fitness, on the well-being, and what kind of topics are included in this definition. Now I try to pull out some of them. It's not exhaustive. It's something that I try to make a wide search around these concepts of health and well-being and something that can be covered by an MEI system. For example, sports. Everything that has to do with sport, with performance, with tracking, with measurement. But beware, there are a lot of fitness trackers, but they are not MEI system. They are just sensing and interfacing. They can sense and they can show you the data. There's no reasoning, there's no acting. They don't do anything on you. They don't do anything for you. They just present you some information that they measure from you. It's only half of the job, okay? So if you want to do something about fitness, you must think about the other half. Maybe I don't know something that is self-adaptive to. So it can be able to change the environment in which you are. I don't finish the sentences because that's your project. So you have better ideas than me. Sports and fitness in general. Fitness is not just sporting, it's also the quality of life, sleep, and so on. Nutrition, in many ways. How much you drink, how much you eat, what you are eating, how often are you eating, or something like that. I saw a fork that if you are eating too fast, it will light up and warn you. Okay, so I try to slow down, okay? If you have $100, you can buy it, okay? $100 for a fork. But again, it's not an MEI system properly. It's a bit better because it already gives you some feedback. It starts flashing. Disability, persons with disability. So people that cannot see, cannot move, cannot hear. So they're related to the health, of course. An ambient system that will help these people do daily jobs in which they are impaired for some reason. It's a domain that is included in this wide definition. And then I try to think about something a bit stranger. So, okay, in the sport, you can have the workouts, so the actual training, the topic of comfort. So are you comfortable here? Is it too hot, too cold, too wet, too noisy, or whatever? So it's part of well-being. We live in a comfortable environment. Dietary, both from, say, weight control, but also for special needs. You have some food that you cannot eat for different reasons, and so you can control the food intake, the quality, the quantity, the nature, I don't know, trying to throw some ideas on the floor. Sleep. There are a lot of sensors they can put under the mattresses. Okay, then my problem is that I don't sleep too much because I have too much to work, but it's not about the mattress, it's about going to holidays. All the everything related to illnesses, so something that can measure your, you know, heart rate or temperature or glucose or, you know, so measurement or condition which we have maybe a permanent illness or temporary one, and in that case the environment may help you dealing with your condition or may help you recovering from your condition. These are general thoughts. Of course, we must come up with specific ideas, okay? All the emotions that are part of well-being, I'm happy, I'm angry, or whatever. Pets. I saw some fitness tracker for cats and dogs. They're selling them, okay? And so it's a strange domain, but why not, okay? It's not easy to bring your dog to the Ladispe to experiment, but it's just a mixture of keywords here. The elderly people, so there are special needs. People that grow older, they can start losing, let's say, part of their brain, they can start losing physical strength and so on. So how can the environment help them? The emergency situation, so calling somebody in case of emergency, in case of an alert, handling emergencies, I don't know, in hospital care or in house or on the street. It's all related to health, of course, but air and light condition is part of comfort mainly. All the topic of prescriptions, you need to take drugs. 3 times a day, legal drugs, I mean. You need to be reminded that you need to take the right one. This is a simple example, but you can combine with something else to come up with a more comprehensive system. Addictions. Addiction means I smoke, I need to quit. I gamble, I need to quit. Other types of addiction that you may have. Or something that helps the environment will help you in not falling into that problem or trying to quit. So try to think wide around these topics. Okay? Everything that is around this qualifies. As long as we can imagine an MEI system with all the balls, the 4 steps. And again, in another expansion of this MEI system is where. Where can we imagine applying one of these or addressing one of these needs? Because actually these are application areas, needs, specific types, categories of systems. Where can be applied? Well, at home, in a car. Make you feel better in your car if you need to drive for many kilometers, or just check your health. Are you drunk? Are you sleepy? There are already sensors for doing that in modern car, in expensive cars, okay? But there are just ideas for starting. On the workplace, on the health and well-being on the workplace, in the gym, if you are doing some, it's related, of course, to sports. So there are different. Imagine when we try, when you think about ambient intelligence, which is the ambient? I imagine at home, at work, in a car, in a gym. And so this gives me an idea about the type of sensors, the type of activities that I'm doing there. The definition says supporting the user in their daily activities. So my daily activities at home are different from my daily activity at the workplace. On transportation, on a train, on a bus, on a public So then will be even different, because my home is my home, I will be there every day. A bus is a bus that is shared by different people, so I cannot maybe rely on some sensor or some knowledge about each individual person. But then maybe, but of course, I might imagine something about that. A hospital or a nursery home or a care residence or something like that. It's a place where people go to feel better, to be healed. In the wilderness, okay, I'm going trekking, I'm going climbing. Of course, I cannot put sensors in every tree in a mountain. I need to rely more on sensors attached to the person, not in the environment, but the environment can play sometimes a role. Maybe I have a bike trail, and so in some places I have some sensors that check whether people have passed through these points or not. So can also imagine open spaces, where maybe the environment is, which is instrumented with where you have the sensors is your bike, or is your backpack, or are your shoes. The ambient is something that is around you, but not necessarily a closed box or a closed room. At a restaurant, or all related to the eating or to the nutrition. You may imagine that probably when we explain that, we imagine that at home or at work, but it may also be in a public restaurant. So try to think and combine and to Google these things. And try to imagine projects. What would be a good idea of an MEI system on health and well-being in the wider sense? Of course, the project will have to cover all the four steps. We already said that, but I didn't say that enough. And this means that some kinds of projects are not acceptable. Mobile-only projects, no. So only something that works only on your smartphone. You have a lot of sensors, you can do a lot of stuff with a smartphone, but it's not enough to qualify as the ambient intelligence. No software only. We need to have some hardware, at least to act on the environment. We may need to build the hardware, we may need to use some hardware that is there, some actuator, some sensor, but a software-only project doesn't qualify. No cloud-only or wearable-only solution. So these are all ingredients that are important. The software, the cloud, the service, the sensor, the mobile. But the project should cover all of them to close the loop to the user. No solutions that are totally automated behind the scenes. Yes, the computer should be disappearing, but if I want to have some interaction, I should be able in some way to exchange information. Maybe not on a screen, but in a different way. If I have a system that says, okay, I'm going to manage your energy or your air in a totally automated way, I'm fine with that, but it's not an MEI system. It's just an optimization system. It's a house plant, it's a technical plant that optimizes some feature. It doesn't interact with the user. It lacks the user interaction. So it's something that is able to manage a plant, a technical plant, the air conditioning plant, for example. You may know it or not, but behind every classroom or every group of classrooms in the Polytechnic, but in all major buildings, there are very big machines that process the air. So all these vents, it's pulling the air out of the classrooms, it's measuring temperature, humidity, CO2, and then it decides whether to cool it, to warm it, to mix it with the outer air, or to recycle it. They are very big machines, but big really, because they need to process cube meters of water of air every minute. So they need very large tubes. We are not aware of them, except that they don't work right. So we feel cold or something like that. But usually they are systems that are programmed to deliver air with some given quality. That's it. They don't care about what you are doing in the classroom. Maybe we are doing a party, or maybe we are doing an exercise, or maybe we are meditating, I don't know. And so maybe we would like to have different kind of air. I don't know, it's just a stupid idea. But the system doesn't react, doesn't care, doesn't interact in any way. So it disappears too much. It's something that optimizes, it's an intelligent system that optimizes some technical quality. No user interaction. And this is not ambient intelligence for us. We need to have some sensing from the environment, or from the user, or from social networks that can be also be able to sense some information, or from some cloud service, or from the user body, or whatever. Or and or, but at least one of these. You should have some sensing, you should have some actuation, changing something on the environment, something on the user. Changing the user is not easy, but you can change a temperature, a vibration, a sound on the user, deliver to the user. And if possible, the system should not be simply deterministic. We don't want a system that just applies one formula or one fixed algorithm with no flexibility. We need it to be adaptive. Cloud services are not part directly of ambient systems, but can be useful additions. Okay, if you use, want to use, I don't know, the Google Calendar, or if you want to use Facebook to understand whether a person is there, is tweeting or not, which are their friends or whatever, we can do that. It's not difficult to do that. In Python, it's very easy. You have the library to connect. You can use them to deliver information or to read information from them. Okay, as long as they are only one component of the system and not the only component of the system. Okay, trying to incorporate most of these features. And just keep in mind that we cannot rebuild a house or rebuild an environment, so we can modify the infrastructure. We can imagine doing that. But if there is something in the walls and the lights, we cannot just go there and change the plant. Especially if we need to show it in La Dispe, we cannot just go and dismantle the La Dispe. We can add something to an environment, but not change too much the way it works. The project should be feasible with the equipment that we have. So, on Monday, we'll go to the lab and we'll show you what kind of devices we have available for you. We have different kinds of stuff that we bought during the years, just to have wide, give you choice or wide flexibility, okay, about what you need. Something that is there, something that you can, that you already have maybe, or you can lend from a friend, or it maybe it's cheap, so you can buy it. But let's try not to imagine a project that relies on some equipment that is not available, because otherwise we'll, okay, be all, you cannot build it with component, with basic components. So it's an additional constraint. Ideally, it shouldn't be there, but we need to work with what we have or what's what will be available in next weeks. And try to think about something that is easy to demonstrate. Something that is easy to, say, install and configure on a desk in lab, and the day after you install it at your home because you need to develop, and then you move it to the incubator to do the showcase. Something that is more or less self-contained or easy to move or easy to reconfigure in different places. Because otherwise it would be actually difficult to show. So, for example, last year we had a project that needed to, with a camera, to watch over parking lots, so to see which parking lots were free or occupied by the cars, or for that can be easy to do or can be moved easily, no, all this stuff. So what they did is they did a scale model with a small parking lot and small machines and the webcam taking a picture of this, say, model of the real parking lot that could be moved easily. Okay, so find a solution to make the project easy to demonstrate. Of course, the focus was not the camera, was the algorithms that were applied after we discovered that the place is free or empty. Okay. So these are the constraints, the topics that you need to think about. I tried in the this afternoon to use this health and well-being and IoT and MAI keywords on Google. I found already some websites, some ideas. You find a lot of stuff. Try to search and think and compare. What you will find in most of the cases, they are not MEI systems. They don't qualify as projects. But they can be used as components, as ideas, as ingredients, as parts of your project. So start exploring so that you can refine your idea and so on. Finally, what I would like to do, in a second, let's first see the practical rules. What I would like to do in a second is to review the answers that you gave to the survey. When I already asked, do you have any idea about health and well-being? So we can read them together. And check and try to understand today. I'm not going to say which was right, which was wrong. It was not an exam. It was just, say, stimulating some ideas. But today, with the filters, we can say, OK, this is not an MEI because it lacks this and that. Huh? So read this together with this purpose. But before that, practically, what do we need to do? So the first steps, practically. First step is discuss and write your idea on a shared document that we have put onto Google Drive. So if you click on this link, you find a document that is empty with a template. And what you need to do is to copy this block and paste it and write your own proposal with a name, as an acronym for the project, the title for the project, the members of the project, and some lines describing the project from the user's point of view. What do the users gain from this project? Why are the users happier or healthier, or there are more well-being after you will create your project? So we will collect the idea. You can write on this document at any time. We will say close it and check what you've written on the 16th of March, and also with the group members. You will also need to create a user login on the GitHub website, if you don't have it already, and tell us that we can enable you into the repositories that we'll create for the project. But these are details that can come later. And think already at the steps and features that you want. We will discuss all of these, or your proposals, in the 17th of March in the classroom. And you have until the next day to finish, to polish, and to write the final version, OK? That will be already discussed in the class. Usually, you have time during that class for the people you can connect and then modify your proposal. Tips, be creative. Find something that you like, that, say, exploits your passions, your ideas. Maybe since you were a child, you were always thinking about, I don't know, fish in the aquarium, and so you want to do something about the well-being of all the fish or all the people, thanks to the movement of the fish, I don't know. If it's something that you already have as a part of your life, it will be much more fun developing it for the course. Concentrate on two or three, I would say one, key features. Okay, something that does very well a very small number of things. Don't try to do many things and none of them so well, just so. Think about the users. What will your users like about your system? Not what do you like. You like it because you love it. It's your child. Okay, but it's not your friend's child. What do the others can like about your project? You can imagine telling your project about a friend, telling to your friend about the project, and they should respond, I want to have it. Not, Who cares? Huh? That's not the right kind of reaction we are seeking from the passionate users. And try to avoid too much work. Okay? We are not counting the number of lines of code that you write. It's not the more the better. No, the less the better. We have a goal, it's very well defined. An MEA system that passes the filter, steps and features. Okay, and is related to health and well-being. That's the only condition. So make it smaller, less work. Don't rely too much on integrating a lot of services or supporting a lot of devices or processing a lot of data. There's nothing bad about this. The problem is that they involve a lot of work, a lot of code. So if you try to not to rely too much on these three areas, it will be easier. Otherwise, you will have to work much more because these are hard parts for the implementation point of view. I'm sure there will be great MEA systems that rely on this, but doing them in a semester course would be difficult. Okay, just a warning. But if you like it, go for it. It's just a suggestion. Okay, so let's spend 10 minutes about what you wrote. By reading together what you wrote. All right. No. Okay, it doesn't like me. So let's try just to skip through to the answers you gave and try to, in your mind, to apply the filters. In some cases, there are very general sentences that say, it would be nice to have a system that does some kind of things. It's not a proposal, okay? Okay, you don't care. But think about your project. It should be something very specific, concrete. So it can be used by command voice. This is a feature. It's not a result. For doing what? Can be available on existing devices. I don't really know what it means. Using wearable devices in order to know more from people who are using the service and to help them with more accurate information. About what? I'm not criticizing those sentences, right? I don't care who wrote them. I'm trying to criticize them in order to find the weaknesses and so that you can avoid those weaknesses in your project, right? The end user is advised on, so it doesn't say what information you have and what you want to do with that. The end user is advised on the best places in their city where people go jogging. Hmm? The end user is informed where special fitness health seminars are happening in their city and how to participate. What is lacking here? Sensing. There's no sensing. It doesn't change the way it works depending on the user actions. It's not adaptive. Green, artistic, and happy. Yes, I don't know what it means. Our body is like a car and responds to what we feed it. To live long and healthy life, we need to be conscious of what we eat and keep track of it. Yes, and so what? It's true. But what are you proposing as a system? I would create an automatic system that provides the perfect illumination and temperature using natural light when possible. For example, the system should open windows, shutters, self-exposed during the winter, but pay attention not to disturb any occupant, only if in the room. And when the sunlight is too low, automatically turn on lights and the right intensity, the same with the heating system. This is an example of an intelligent plant that doesn't interact with the users. They follow some lighting algorithm, but there's not much interaction with the user. Brutalizes on the steering wheel, which doesn't allow the car ignition in the event of prohibited values. I think it's already a commercial system in many cars. Huh? But this may apply. It senses and it acts something on the car. It's not very adaptive. So it's a threshold because there's a low regulation. No? Say, okay, if it's above this threshold, you don't drive. Remote medical consultation service via video call, just a cloud service An application that with a scan of the barcode of the product recognizes the presence of substances which are allergic for your body. This could be one place, one function inside a project. Okay, about nutrition. Not enough because that you just scan a barcode, but then this information can be used as kind of sensing. A reminder for the last time you went to run for a park. How long have you been sitting without moving and doing that job? This is sensing what you're doing. And it's trying to push you to do, but it's not very acting. I think the smart devices should simplify human life. Okay. For example, in our home, could be useful a device that can control temperature and light of the environment. We already have that. For a housewife, it would be a fantastic thing to control all appliances of her own home. But it doesn't have too much to do with the health and well-being in this case. No, it's more home automation in general. Improve the basic teaching system to get rid of ignorance and poverty. I could sign it, but it would be better if we start using the bike instead of the car. Yes? If you are, okay, it's, if I understand the question correctly, to my mind nowadays, it would be great to design some device which help all people with disabilities to send data to hospital, and if something went wrong, the ambulance will help them. So an automatic alerting system. Also, the system should be smart, not to annoy doctors and users. So if you're already dead, don't bother them. And it should be some smart statistic mechanism, which maybe in the future will help to avoid some health problems. We need to be more specific in this case. Okay? Could be an idea, but we need to be more specific. A program determines the nutritional value of food once inserted name, quantity, and brand. It could be combined with a barcode scanner, because inserting the brand number for every food that you take is not a killer feature. Furthermore, it's able to determine the characteristic of a meal, collecting various statistics. Yes, and then, okay, this is again part of the sensing, a bit of that analysis, and then what do you do? Students are provided with virtual teaching system. Workers don't have a hard job physically. The houses are better smart devices and use the technology. The industry doesn't harm the nature. They can see anything there. I will create something that will help the elderly, like a device that tells you when to take the pill and or which one. This is already existing, but we may think about improving that. The system should be something the end user might forget to have, but he or she can manage it whenever she wants in an extremely easy way. Maybe about losing items. That sensor should be in order objects the user already uses and not in on-purpose devices in his or out of his school. And control will be done via smartphone or similar. Regarding health and personal info, you focus the attention on the project, also on extreme privacy for the users. Privacy is very important. We don't have time to deal with security in this project. So our project will be extremely unsafe, extremely unsecure, but with really, they can be cracked in any second by, so. In this description, what you see is that it only describes technology, a device that does this, smartphone, but it doesn't talk about the user, what the user will do with that. Create an interface with a mass of various instruments. The interface will be monitoring and be monthly blood test via medical service and daily heart rate and body heat and blood pressure, and so physical conditions. Data will be used by the interface once more to suggest a diet, sleeping hours needed, and even optional exercise plan. It's a bit complex to get right to have all the system working, but actually you see the loop closing. Bonus, the interface will also be able to suggest where exactly the user could buy the food for the specific diet. This is something which is good on marketing. Calculating the distance, quality, and cost ratio of the latter, okay. A system targeting possibly anyone that helps and the regular is one's daily routine. Or something focusing on compensating blinding or deafness, working on enhancement for the working sense. Something that helps you shutting down your social connection temporarily for social media dependent people. So there are three different ideas. We just need to go beyond something and explaining what is this something. Without any refuse, I don't know, without any stress to use environment with a natural power. I think that a good system could improve our health and well-being, could be control home ambient humidity and temperature, quality air. Imagine that sometime we'll have to need a safety air at home in order to save our life. And you coming at home can choose the ambient condition as today you use the climate system in the car. So probably it's good for the Mars colonies to have indoor air. It facilitates my life at home, yeah? I can have a continuous control of my well-being without involving other people directly. I don't need to rely on my sons, probably for elder people, but the first two are very general, so I can't infer any specific project from that. An application for smartphone wearable that has diabetes. It can take information for a glycemia meter, placing my arm, but also other meters, blood pressure, for example, and learning my lifestyle. It gives me advices and reminds me of what to do. Take my insulin, for example. There's a bit lacking on the acting part. First of all, the environment should be easy for using, clear UI design, short process to finish the work. Then, of course, functional user needs, of course, but which ones? Extra function that can be provided. Great user privacy security. We are near at the end. Through an app, the housewife knows exactly what food is in her fridge. It's difficult. The app suggests healthy recipes with the right amount of calories for each family member. Nobody is ever going to scan the barcode of every item he puts into the fridge. Food will not be wasted. A sensor to point when too much time has been spent while sitting. So something under your chair, I imagine. Calculating and showing how to reduce the humidity in the air. Device that improves athlete's skill, movements and muscular work. Focusing in particular on monitoring muscle used during exercises by the athletes. This is something, it's too monitoring and too not very interacting or acting, but it's a domain that can be used. Eating habits for intense routine. Providing good education for better awareness. Encourage people to have good habits, improve and back up researches. Have an interconnected positive environment where discussing and confronting problems together is encouraged. I don't know how to do that. People should be able to share their knowledge in any field with others and also to support each other. I don't think it's relevant. Self-driven car, which can be used by the driver without car license, for example, for disabled people. Just a small project, okay? System for car parking in large city, auto navigation to a regular book place, optimization, time, or emissions, is not very relevant to the health and well-being. A smart environment should be created thinking to the satisfaction achievable by the user in respect of his personal and natural way of living. Yes, but what? In my opinion, domestic and town city environment does influence health and well-being. As a user, I would live in a smart city which shares information with their citizen, giving updates about city status and allowing people to manage better their own time. Very general, generic. Health and well-being, the start of an ambitious, I don't know, to feel good and live well. Health and well-being services for students include well-being services, the University Health Center, faith and spiritual guidance and disability. It's a bit wide. Intelligent pantries inventory, which isn't easy to know what is missing. A centralized automatic control for the house light. So there were some ideas. Of course, it was not requested to give the proper definition of a project at that time. It's normal that you can see maybe only this, the sensing is the easy part. You see that in many times the acting or the adaptation are a bit lacking, something that you need to work on. Because we are used to systems that are closed on interfaces, we need to widen our thoughts about systems where the whole environment is part of the interface, not just a smartphone, not just a computer. Okay, so these are just, there are good ideas there. You need to try to be more specific. And if you have ideas, just share them with us and we'll discuss them in the next weeks. Thank you, good evening.